I think Krishnamurti was a very fresh breath of air in the 20th century. He was saying things which were at one level very challenging, at another level throwing people into crisis. And I think the crisis has not vanished, because the kind of questions he asked are as relevant today as they were in the last century. He spoke to the depths of human beings. He spoke of the crisis in human consciousness and asked very simply if a fundamental transformation was possible. He left a very rich legacy. He also left a legacy of the manner in which he did things and some of the very challenging things he said. For instance, he said, "These are the teachings, tear it to bits." He allowed people who were reading to kind of look into it and think about it completely independently, and he never built any kind of dependence. It's very difficult if you think of a religious teacher who has said, "These are the teachings, tear it to bits. These are things I have discovered, but you're well welcome to kind of look at it afresh." Do we dare to say this in small measure or large to people when we speak? We are usually so concerned about being understood rightly that we often get very worried, anxious when we speak, either to children or to colleagues or to the world at large, people whom we don't know. We get very anxious if we are understood differently from the way in which we want to be understood, or which we think we want to be understood. Krishnamurti saw the emergence of computers long ago. He said machines are going to take over the work of man, and he asked, "What will you do then? What will you do when machines take over your time, your work, much of your work?" He refused to become an authority, and he said, "Question everything." And he said to teachers, which are particularly relevant to administrators and heads of schools, he said, "Get off the pedestal." So this ground he set consistently, very clearly, and created the ground of conversations, created the ground of dialogue. So at the outset, I'd like to say that I am enjoying the privilege of working in the Krishnamurti School from 1990. My colleague Sailesh has been in these schools from 1983, 35 years. My doors have always been open to teachers, and students could walk in any time. Of course, we don't have air conditioners in our schools, and the doors therefore can be kept open. And the windows can be also open so you can see what's outside. My table has never been clear. I would drop most things if someone walked in through the door, and I would listen to that person, and I learned a lot about listening. It has been a great privilege that this exercise of having a messy table, because whatever you're doing, you have to stop if you have to listen to the person who's coming through the door. So I'll begin with a little story. In 2010, I got a letter from a woman in Italy. And she said, "In 1993, I met you, and you spent a little time with me. You may not even remember me." This is 17 years ago. I couldn't remember her, really. She said, "You were very kind, and you spoke to me." And then she went on to an elaboration of her statement in her life. And she said, "Look, I have come into a lot of money, and I want to leave a legacy for your school." It was an extraordinary experience to even get the letter. Then we went and did meet her in Italy, and then she described the whole situation. She was difficult. She was having a difficult situation, and she had come to school, and I had spent just 10 minutes with her, and it seems to have been something that she remembered for 17 years. When I went with our senior children in the school where I used to work for 21 years, we took them on various trips around the country. One of the trips was to the Barefoot College. In the winter months, we would travel for 2 weeks or 3 weeks. We said, "Children need to understand what India is. They need to understand what the two Indias are, the other India which they rarely see. the India of the cities is not the only India. And we met this gentleman called Bhavar Dada in Barefoot College, an unlettered man who did not been to school. He could not read or write. But he was the architect of the Barefoot College. The architect had made some drawings on the ground and left. So this man had built the whole institution. And he was completely unprepossessing, very, very simple, wearing dusty clothes. And as we were leaving, somebody asked him, what would you say to these children? And he gave only one piece of advice. He said, if somebody says they want to talk to you, never say you don't have time. Now, we are talking about behavior. Now, listening, time, they seem to be connected. Because when somebody wants to speak, is that the time when I'm free? Does the urge to speak come with the time-bound structure, say, between 9:28 and 9:32? You have to finish whatever you want to say. It rarely works like that. And our children, I think this has left a very deep impression in their minds. Anyway, so I want to say a little bit more about my work as well and also introduce myself slightly differently. During my time as principal, I've never failed a child, and children haven't failed me. I think not injuring the spirit of a child is the first priority of any head or any teacher. And what do I mean by this? We have school, we have a structure, you have a certain number of children in a class. When children, we create the class. The class doesn't exist. Each child comes as an individual to join the school. We create the class. And then research shows that, I mean, the quality of academics and the quality of performance is not terribly different in well-to-do schools and in government schools, etc., etc. And therefore, I do not manage to communicate something in mathematics or science or history or something to the child. And then I fail the child. And it's a public shaming. You strip the child of all dignity and put the child in a younger class or whatever, all because you think that the child next is, you are doing the right thing. You have your rules, you have your regulations. But what are you doing to the spirit of this child? I have never had to fail any children. And the one crisis I had in my life, the first year of as principal, was there was this fantastic bright child at Kashmiri parents. But everybody was sure that he was going to fail the ICSE examination. Everybody was sure. And all these teachers were discussing, I believe ICSE are allowed to fail in one subject or something like that. So they were all discussing which subject should he be allowed to fail in, and therefore other subjects could therefore take interest. So this argument went on for almost 45 minutes, and I was a new principal. I didn't know what to do with this. But finally, I managed to find a good question. I said, okay, let's say we fail this boy. We hold this boy back. Can you guarantee that he will pass next year? They said, "I don't be funny. We have had him for 10 years. We can't guarantee that he'll pass. What makes you think that?" Then I said, "What's your problem? Let him write the exam." He passed. You know, so how wrong we can be in our assumptions, in our estimations, in our anxieties. It was a classic example for me. And after that, it became completely clear to me that exams are difficult to fail in. If you take care of the well-being of the child, the whole child, if you don't invalidate the person, and this does not mean just being sweet all the time and being kind all the time, etc., etc. The relationship is not always a very sweet thing and a gentle thing which gives you a nice stroke. It's not like that. But I think you have a wholesome relationship with children, and school is a place which is valuable to the child. You will find that children won't do very badly. I mean, at least that's been my experience. Okay, 20 years. It may be a small drop in the ocean, but I'd like to say that. I'm going to speak in the anecdotal mode. Silesh has spoken with reference to Krishnamurti. Maybe you can connect some of these things there. Probably in Mumbai you have the same thing. We have it in Chennai. Very orthodox society we had 20 years ago. And people would want their children to get into medical college and engineering college, and they would say, when we put them, you must give them maths, physics, chemistry. Can you make sure that child will get into a good college? I would say, I'm really not bothered about what marks the child will get. I have only three concerns, and my concerns are, no child should think of suicide. No child should think that he or she doesn't have a dignified place in the world. Furthermore, no child should think that the world is poor in opportunities. Are we sometimes unwittingly doing this because with in tuning into the anxiety that is there in society about performance, about success? Krishnamurti also said, what's wrong with being poor? Is it if you want to be a gardener, be a good gardener? I mean, to him it was not at all important what vocation you took. Having academic excellence, it beautifully offering a good academic experience, working diligently, working hard. But does it automatically translate into marks? And do we have to fail children if we have to get the mark? These are very serious questions. So I think this question of what academic excellence means is a very important question for schools to go into. And we have to separate it a little bit from exam performance, I feel. You know, Mark Twain mentioned that he never let his schooling interfere with his education. And I think we need to work out what's the relationship between schooling and certification. We are already saying that certification has become possible in multiple ways through multiple media and through digital platforms and all kinds of things. Therefore, is it necessary to say that schooling is an experience and certification is an event? And in the zone of lifelong learning, certification is now going to be serial certification. So we really actually have no basis for giving too much value to certification. So the role actually deeply nourish the spirit of the individual child who has come, who has wandered into your school for God knows what reason, wandered into my school for what reason, I don't know. But I have a responsibility to engage with this child and to provide a nourishment for the spirit of the child. And to narrow our vision into certification is actually to run away from the responsibility that we actually have. Now, we are living in very interesting times. We are living in times when the media that we are talking about, that computers, the techniques that are overtaking the system. Many years ago, I was in a principal's conference in Bangalore somewhere, and there was a gentleman from Microsoft who made a presentation to 800,000 principals, and he was saying that Microsoft was able to open its software and give it to the schools at very low cost, this, that, and everything. And it was a very, very interesting talk suggesting that this was the best thing for schools to do. So at the end of this presentation, there were some questions, and I asked him one question. Please tell me, will using Microsoft software or any other software, will my child in my school see options, or will his mind be closed to other options? I'm concerned that child must see multiple possibilities. There are multiple solutions to situations in life. I don't want my child to see only one situation in life. So will taking your software, will it actually do this, or will it make him addicted to your software or make him dependent on your software so he can't think beyond it? Thank you. Very kind of you. He said, I can't talk about it. I only know about my product. I think we must be very careful with technology. Sorry, I'm going to take a very different tack on this. We must be extremely careful with technology. We must understand that techniques make us dependent. They make us, what should I say? That we start thinking only in those terms. It's okay to use Apple or Microsoft or Ubuntu or whatever, but what you want to achieve and what you want to do with this, I call this a donkey, you know. My donkey must do what I want it to do. The donkey can't decide what I must do. Right? So we have to keep technology and technique at that level. Is it serving our fundamental intention? Is it serving a purpose? And if it is not, we have to be extremely careful about it. See, some of the conversation that we had over yesterday, I mean, both Sailesh and I have been through very premier educational institutions, so you will bear with me if I make a few observations on this. I think, yes, tech computers have their place. But the crisis today is not what we will do with computers. The crisis is what will we do with each other when we meet around a table. Can we have a conversation without LinkedIn, Facebook, WhatsApp, or SMS, or emails? Or do we really have a crisis when we see a human being in before us? The problem of today, in fact, technology is stealing our consciousness, is stealing our attention so much that we have a real crisis. What does the presence of another human being in my life mean? What if I was following Bhavar Dada's instruction from Barefoot College, and he said, don't say no to somebody who comes and wants to ask you a question or talk to you. Well, how would I talk to this human being? Do I have any platform at all? Or do I only judge him, what's your number, what's your this, and therefore I'll send you a message, I'll send you an emoticon. People are even telling you how you should express your emotions. Can you imagine? So, are we fodder for the machines, or the machine is a tool for our use? We really have to understand this. In the 21st century, something very important is happening. It's the leading up from the 20th century. In the 20th century, if you see a film called The Century of the Self, you will understand how this whole business of marketing, whole business of public relations, of influencing people's behavior has happened. It has happened not by chance, not by accident. It's carefully planned and carefully designed. People know, the people who are doing marketing and branding and all kind of things, they know that certain kinds of things, through their research, certain kinds of things are more attractive to people. Marketers are today paying great attention to children. 65% of the purchase decisions of homes are made by children. So all the advertisement is directed towards children, a very, very big part of it. So they have a product to sell. And you and I, as teachers, who are asking this young person to think, do we have a product to sell, or are we in a different zone altogether? Therefore, if the teacher were to say, look, I'm not in the business of selling. I'm not in the business of recommending your product to my children. I'm in the business of helping my child think, understand, listen carefully, to be able to make sensible decisions in life. Not get hustled, not get pushed around, not get invalidated. I think therefore the teacher's role becomes somewhat different, and I think to what Mr. Patel was asking, this is the dimension where I think we have to understand that just ease of delivering content, etc., is not the zone that we need to be worried about. Content is available on every platform at whatever time you want, but is that our business? The other day we had a little conversation around the dining table. I have lots of conversations with children. That's my main job. Once a child was asking, what do you do in school? So I told him, no, I just talk to people. Whoever comes, I talk to people, or sometimes I go and worry them and talk to them. That's my job in school. So anyway, so this conversation at school was very interesting. So I was asking, what did you do in vacation? What have you enjoyed doing with your parents and people at home? And he said, I went to Yerkad 3 days, and then I went to Vandalur Zoo. I really enjoyed that, you know. So I was asking people, what did you hear him saying? Everybody repeated the content, you know. All the other children who were sitting around, we said, no, he went, he enjoyed the place, he liked going there. I think he saw some animals which he liked. Then I hazarded a guess. I said, I think he's saying that he was happy that he could go there with his parents and he enjoyed the kind of community feeling together that he had with his family and the other people who came with him. The boy was feverishly nodding away. So you see, listening is an art, what Silesh was talking about. You can't be trapped in the words. And the machines are not teaching you this. But the marketers are understanding this. So what they are telling you is not what they are telling you. The subliminal messages of marketing are far more powerful. Now the question for you and me as teachers is, are we in the zone where are accepting our role as purveyors of a product? Or is our zone the awakening of intelligence? Krishnamurti talked about the awakening of intelligence. Intelligence is not following. You know, I wonder if we would like to say that our children should be empowered participants in society, not just fit in. Horrible things are happening all around us. There were riots in Delhi in 1984, 2002 it was Godhra and Gujarat. I would like to say that none of my children would be involved in this mob behavior. I'm speaking for myself as a person. If I have educated a child, that this child will not get into unthinking mob behavior. Will not treat another human being just as different because he has a different religion, or a different color, a different caste, different clothes. You see, we have to understand the implications of this very clearly. Do we really want children to be empowered participants? And that would mean they would be difficult to invalidate, that they can stand their ground. They have thought through something so clearly that they will not get stuck. Because otherwise, in the drift of things, in the movement of things, people do get trapped, people do get carried away, and then we regret it later. Okay? I have always said that the teacher's job is only for the bravest of the brave in the 21st century. So I'm not going to say any easy things, etc. But I think it's only a challenge for people who are willing to embrace this adventure of being a teacher. It's an extraordinary role, and it's a role which is not in the hands of the marketplace. Unfortunately, education has gone with GAT and all the other trappings of the marketplace. Education has become business. More and more people talk about it as business. Unfortunately, it's an affair of the heart. It's not of the money and the pocket. Education is something else. Particularly when you recognize that content. You know, in late 1990, there was a man called Michael Saylor. And he went on a boat ride with his friends in his yacht in near California. And he then suddenly decided that he was going to invest $100 million in a world-class university which will provide digital content free to the whole world. $100 million. That was a lot of money at that time, I think. After that, I never heard of him. But the next thing I heard was MIT was putting its course material on the net. Other people started putting their course material. Content is available on the net in large ways. Khan Academy is, of course, something else altogether. But content is available freely on the net. So what is the role of the school and the teacher if it is not to deliver content? How do we, for instance... One second. How do we, for instance, think of something called honesty, respect? Do we have tools for understanding this or validating this? Not ritual respect. Ritual respect is finished. You know, cultural ritual respect, whenever you see an elder person, I mean, okay, it's great, it's wonderful if you can do it. But respect, I think, is something else. Does respect, Krishnamurti talked about choiceless awareness, but is there something called choiceless respect? That irrespective of who the person is, irrespective of man, woman, child, that we, somewhere in the course of our education, we have seen that this is absolutely essential. And this means you listen to every voice as carefully as you would listen to every other voice. I mean, it's too... Some... icon, okay, I'm not going to name people, cricket icon or film icon or some business icon, then people all sit up and everybody gets very agitated and very excited. But on the way, did they look at the face of the man who was at the door? Did they manage to see the person who was serving them food? Did they look at the face? Did they notice the tiredness in somebody's eyes? Did they notice somebody who, not having iconic status, did they actually observe something there? Or we have sold our souls to icons? Is that what's happened to us? In that case, I would call their education has been neglected by their teachers and by the institutions who made money out of educating them but sold them content. Honesty, respect, listening, openness. We talked a lot about openness. Openness is not an idea. It's not just a notion that we have. How are we? Are we open to all the various influences? Can we listen to completely different views with great respect and attention? And this requires something much more, because we are also trapped in our feelings. Our feelings sweep us in one direction and the other. I find that you must have noticed that in your schools, there's a very beautiful girl or there's a very handsome boy and people want to hang around that person. And if they are not in that inner circle, they feel neglected, they feel defeated, right? Now, how is this person going to learn to deal with this feeling? How is the person going to understand this feeling? I'm feeling lost, I'm feeling lonely. Walking along the road, I had a very interesting experience one day. One evening after dinner, one girl tells me, "You know, Anna, I'm very jealous. You know, I feel very jealous when that girl was talking to that boy or that girl was talking to that girl. And I felt this girl was neglecting me. I discovered it was burning inside me." And she said it so casually, so easily. I really envied her. At her age, 13, 14, if I had experienced jealousy, I would be able to say it. So it was a very beautiful moment that this child could own it up for herself. And all I could tell her was that I really appreciate the fact that you're able to say it and see it with this honesty. But can you just watch and see where it's coming from? What's happening? Why are you dependent on that person? Just try to understand it for yourself. I can't tell her. You see, the problem with most religions, and Krishnamurti had a lot to say about religion. The problem with most religion is that feelings, anger, jealousy, sadness, envy, hate, bitterness. You shouldn't have these feelings. You're supposed to wipe them off. Fellow feeling, sexuality, sexual feeling for somebody. You have to wipe them all out. You can't have them. You're only supposed to have warm feeling, caring feeling, helpful feeling, nothing else. Everything else is out. But here was a man who said, "Can you watch anger like a jewel?" Now, what does that mean? So he really opened a door, which I think is very important for human society to consider. This is our experience, your experience and my experience. And this is the experience of people around. This girl spoke about her jealousy. Now, it's not as if just because we grow older, we are free of all these feelings. We have feelings. How do we help young people understand feelings without guilt? With understanding it deeply. And thereby going, maybe with that understanding, it'll take them wherever it takes them. Do we have a way of talking to children about feelings? Because if we don't have a way of handling feelings, then the feelings run your life. Feelings of betrayal, feelings of anger, feelings of jealousy. So these are the things that are guiding our lives. It is not all the moral stuff that we've been told. So we are now in a zone where whatever we are doing can be improved. It's a very difficult truth, but we are in a zone where whatever we are doing can be improved. Learning and contributing go hand in hand. So you see, at the flip of the century, lifelong learning, everything, something changed. You heard about that young boy, 17-year-old boy, who already started something, company. You heard about another 10 or 13-year-old boy who had made a difference, or a girl who had made a difference to her community. There was this fantastic 14-year-old in San Francisco Pakistani, a boy who heard about the murder of a Pakistani weaver child, and therefore he set up a beautiful multi-million dollar organization. So young people can do quite a lot, and I'm not talking only about money. I think learning and contributing go hand in hand. In the zone of lifelong learners, it's not as if you have to learn and then contribute. That is an old metaphor, it's dead. In the new world of serial certifications, and this has always been possible, wherever one is, if one has openness, one can see what has to do, one can always make a difference, one can contribute to the culture, one can contribute to the beauty of a place, one can contribute to the well-being in other human beings. So this has always been possible. And lastly, I'm going to speak about only one thing, and that's working together. We know we are not perfect. Our schools are work in progress, and we'll be learning and doing. Whatever we do can be improved. Does this mean that we'll only pool our inadequacies together because we work in silos? Working together is not just a superficial working together. Working together deeply, putting aside the barriers that we have with each other, actually, it requires a great deal of effort and a great deal of energy to be able to do this. When we listen to Krishnamurti or the Buddha or somebody like that, we feel we are so inadequate. And Krishnamurti makes a very interesting comment in the book called The Flame of Learning. He says to a teacher, when the teacher says, I have not ended fear in my life, how do I speak about ending of fear to students? And Krishnamurti says, speak, and as you speak, you will learn. So it's not as if we are going to be coming as arrived souls to kind of, drone over other people's head. I mean, I think we need to work at the same level along with everybody else. So I think I'll conclude here by just merely saying that I'd just like to build on that last comment that Silesh made. The teacher, I don't think, belongs to society. The teacher was never meant to validate and accept all that society is. Our role is not just to help children fit into society. It's a dangerous ground, but our role is not just to endorse and accept whatever is happening in society. But I think apart from just taking a role which is only to condemn what's happening in society and become separated from society, I think there is a role for the teacher to question what's happening in society, to examine it, to open it out for conversation, to discuss it, and let the nuances show themselves. And in the process of the discussion and the conversation, I trust that people will learn what they leave, what they need, and what they understand. The teachers are also seed bearers. We can't look at our efforts in this direction deterministically. I can't say I have talked to my child and therefore my child has understood respect, listening and care. We are seed bearers. We cast the seeds. The seeds will bloom when they bloom, maybe years later. Maybe even the person concerned may not even remember where it comes from. The teacher, therefore, I think embraces something which is extremely potent, extremely valuable, and that is anonymity. The teacher doesn't choose to become an icon in the eyes of the child, and thereby stays true to his fundamental, his or her fundamental calling, that is to set the child free and not to bind the child in any manner. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
The difference between intellect and intelligence. Then we'll go.
Well, as I understand it, intellect is essentially a process of reason, applying analytical skills, logic, knowledge, all these applied as skillfully as possible. And it is something cumulative. It is something which can, in which technology plays a part and so on. Intelligence, perhaps, is a much more subtle quality. It includes intellect, but it is something much more than intellect. In fact, in the original, they say the original root meaning of that word, if you actually break down that word, it is interlegere, that means reading in between the lines. For example, when you're listening to a person, what do you listen to? Certainly we listen to the words, but can we, is it possible to listen behind the words, beyond the words, in between the words, to listen to a person himself or herself, what they are actually saying? Because there may be something being said which is quite different from the words themselves. Is it possible when one reads a book to have that kind of a sense of what is being conveyed to us, which may be quite different from just the lines in the book? So intelligence is a much more subtle and living quality, which perhaps is more related to sensitivity and capacity to listen, to see, than to just analyze. But it includes the power to analyze. If necessary, one has to be able to analyze. One has to be able to reason very logically, to work out consequences, to project forwards and backwards in time. All that is part of intellectual skill. But intelligence needs to be something much deeper and much more subtle than that. And it's a quality which we need very hard to work at awakening, fully knowing that it is not something that you can hold in your hand. It's not some capacity that you can just pass over. But in talking over, in pointing out, in exploring something, we may perhaps come upon this thing. It can grow on its own.
Since we did open the floor for a question, we have one more question. We'll take this as the last question from the audience, and requesting delegates to please connect during the break time with the speakers.
The question is, how do we avoid becoming a part of someone else's agenda? How do we stop children from becoming fodder for the world? Very interesting question.
So I'll begin and say some things, and maybe Silesh would like to add something after that. The word fodder is very interesting. Fodder. And we are seeing that. Krishnamurti pointed this out, actually. He said children grow up and they fade away into the woodwork. He said we throw them to the wolves. And I think the metaphor is, I think in the way the question is phrased, one can feel the pain and the anguish of the situation, which is what it is in some sense. How do we do this? So who is the we in this? Is it institutions? Is it school? And schools are very rich places. It's not just one person, but there's a group of people who are working. In there, working together, are they deeply pondering this question? Are they very much interested in addressing this issue? Do we want to make sure that the individuals who are studying here are actually learning the art of questioning, thinking, not being gullible, not falling for something or the other just because it's glossy and is sweetly put, or it smells nice or whatever. And by the way, smelling nice is a very important thing. Marketers nowadays in the various departmental stores, they add smells so that people will linger and therefore they'll buy. So this is happening. So how is the intelligence to be triggered, kept awake? How is this person listening or observing whatever is happening around him or her so that he doesn't get trapped in what the world is wanting him to do or the direction the world is pushing him in or him or her? I think this is very critical. So I think it's a very important question. How do we do this? Do we have enough conversations about this? Would you, for instance, consider having a conversation around a topic like this, saying, how do we get influenced? What are the various ways in which we get influenced by another person? Why do we do this? Is it because we are lazy to think for ourselves? Is it because we don't trust our thinking and we think we better go along with somebody else? Is it that we want to belong to a group and therefore whatever questions come, we just abandon it and fall in line? What are the reasons why we do this? And both questions are actually connected. How do we become part of someone else's agenda? Somebody wants to sell. How do I become the buyer? Somebody is wanting to give a particular agenda and he has an agenda. He wants to sell computer, cool drinks, colored chemical water, wants to sell us some glossy looking thing, or sell us an idea, sell us an ideology. How do we become people who just consume it or make it our own? I think it's a very critical question, because I think if we don't have ways of communicating or talking about these issues with children, then it'll be unexamined ground. And therefore, it'll be going on. By the way, in 1997, Ralph Nader, he made this observation, 1997, that he said, the corporations are telling children, we will tell you how to lead your life. Your parents don't know how to lead. They're old-fashioned. And he said, billions of dollars are going into advertising and marketing, and that's what's happening. So it's part of a very organized plan that's going on. And I think, therefore, it's not going to be easy to do this, because you'll find children coming and saying, no, it's what's wrong with this? I like that idea. And delay their own thinking, because belonging to a group becomes far more important than standing alone and thinking for oneself. But Krishnamurti also said, to stand alone is to be truly related. Now, that's worth examining as well. Would you like to add something?
Perhaps one aspect which needs to be understood in this question is the nature of dependence. Why do we become dependent? Why do we want leaders? Why do we lean on leaders? Why do we create leaders, of political leaders, for example? You see this happening all over the world, and they invariably cause havoc. But it is we who create them. It's people who create the leaders. Well, why do we create them? And unless we understand this phenomenon in ourselves, we will endlessly replicate it. So it replicates right from the small groups in school to the big whole of society. It's something which we need to come to terms with.